Well, good morning, Parkside. How are we doing this morning? How is everyone? Won't you stand to your feet? We're going to spend some time just worshiping the Lord.
Surrounds me. Just one word, the darkness has to retreat. Just one touch, I feel the presence of heaven. Just one touch, my eyes were open to see. My heart can't help but be. There's nothing that I God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that I God can't do. Just one word, you heal what's broken inside. Just one word, you revive every dream. Just one touch, I feel the power of heaven. Just one touch, my eyes were open to see. My heart can't help but be me. There's nothing that I got can't. Not a mountain that He can move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that I got can't do. Oh, there's nothing that I got can't do. There's not a prison wall He can't break through. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that I got. Savior, my defense. No more fear in life or death.
I know how the story ends. We will be with you again. You're my Savior, my defense.
we come to you this morning and we're singing about your promises, just who you are and what you mean to us. So God, as we sing these words, we know through scripture that every word you say is true. At least that's what we want to believe. So I just pray this morning that whatever might be in our way, that we're able to just be present and just be here with you. So God, go before us. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. Amen. I want you guys to have a seat. Well, once again, good morning. How is everyone today? You guys doing well? It's a little chilly out. We have just a couple announcements we want to tell you about. The first thing is Beach Acres Parenting Night is coming up in May. And this night, we're looking for volunteers. This is an easy way for you to be plugged in, to be involved. I have been running sound at these events before, and it's amazing. Just to be able to see these parents, these fostering parents, be here, but we need help with babysitting. So if you're interested in that, check it out in the lobby. There's a sign-up sheet that you can check out. Just join and check it out. The next thing that we have is the International Prayer Partners are looking for people, partners, to be praying for our international missions. I know that just from personal experience, I know everyone kind of has different times that they like to pray. Maybe if you have a long drive or if you like to walk through your neighborhood. My youngest daughter, who is 6, prays for one of our mission partners every single night and every single day, which obviously just makes me super proud. But that is something that she is thinking about constantly. So how old do you have to be a prayer partner? It can be for all ages. And so every time that she prays for this person, it makes me think of her, what that person is doing, where they are, where they're serving, and to be a little bit more specific with my prayers. It doesn't take a lot of time to be able to do that, but that's something that you can be doing. And you can check that out in the lobby as well, just to be signing up for that. If you are new to Parkside, you may be seeing something in a bulletin or somewhere else that says, live generously. And this is something that we've been doing for the last couple of years. We're finding ways through our time, our talent, and our treasure to serve, to give back. And one of the ways that you can do that is through a live generously grant. And this is if you have an idea or a project that's going to connect to the community to give back, you can make a huge difference by applying for one of these grants. If you've got an idea or something in your head that you just want to run by us, feel free to check that out on parkside.com/livegenerously and just apply for a grant. Give us your idea. Tell us what you want to do, how you would want to make a difference. This past week, I got to sit down with my friend Becca, and she told a story of her grant that she had approved and what that grant was about. Check this out.
My name's Becca Kaplinger. I had first heard about the Live Generously grant on stage here at Parkside. I volunteer at a food pantry close by during the week, and I had just overheard them with a need that they had for these power packs, which are just these individual bags of food prepared, like snacks and meals for kids to take home on the weekend. It's for low-income kids who, you know, school may be the only time that they eat. And so when they're off school for the weekends, they don't have as much food. So I overheard that they were just having an issue getting the food and the prices were rising. And I feel like God prompted me to kind of connect the dots between the grant and the food pantry that I help. So yeah, I just felt like God really prompted me to do that, and I stepped out and I put in the application and it was approved. So I asked for a week's worth because it was kind of pricey, but I wanted to do 300 power packs, and God was able to stretch that money to 420. So I bought a Sam's Club membership and went and bought all the food, and my kids helped some putting them together, and Yeah, it took a little while, and I had some issues, like, family-wise and personal. My car got hit, and so I didn't have a car for a while, and so it just took me longer than I expected to get it done and to take it to them. But that whole time, you know, God was providing, and providing with cars and with friends and just people willing to help me out and to be able to finish up the project. So initially, I had wanted to write out a Bible verse to stick in with the power packs, just so kids know, you know, who God is and that He loves them. But since these were going into schools, they said I wasn't allowed to write like anything, you know, super religious. So that's how I just kind of came up with the phrase, you know, "You are loved," and I handwrote all those out just to make it a little more personal and special for the kids and the families that got them. Yeah, I would say just do it. It's not hard. It was a pretty easy form to fill out. And especially if you feel like that prompting from God to, you know, do something or help in a certain way, it's best to just be obedient and go for it and see what happens.
How cool is that? Thanks, Becca, for doing that. Thanks for applying for that grant. And I just love her perseverance, too. I mean, gosh, she said somebody hit her car in the midst of it. She's like, "I'm still getting there. I'm still doing this." That's powerful stuff. If you're cynical at all like me, you know, when Jake comes up and he goes, "Hey, we want to tell you about Live Generously, something we've been doing for a couple years," you go, "Oh, they're asking for money." And I just think it's so cool that we're a church that says, okay, we want to put our time, our talent, our treasure where our heart is. We want to put it towards the community, the people that Jesus cares about, all of our neighbors. And to see that, you know, yeah, hey, we want to tell you about Live Generously. And we want to help you be generous with your time and your talent. And if that means us using some of our treasure to help make that happen, I hope you go online. I hope you pray about it. And you do. You think, how can I be a part of something? Whether it's helping out with the babysitting night, helping out with our prayer partners, or maybe it is. Maybe it's a Live Generously grant. There's a place, there's a thing that God wants you to jump into and to do. So my name's Matt Robinson, and we are going through this Gospel of Mark series. And last week, Randy Adams did just a wonderful job talking through the beginning of Mark chapter 6, and he asked the question, have we really placed our faith in Jesus? Do we really believe in Jesus? Do we really know Jesus, or do we just know about Him? It's a great question that we should ask, and if you haven't asked yourself that already, or if you haven't watched this message already, I really encourage you to go online, our social media, YouTube, our Facebook, and check that video out, check that message out. It's going to be worth your time. Have you ever felt overlooked? Have you ever felt like you were wondering if doing the right thing pays off when you feel like everyone else does whatever they want and gets away with it all around you, while you're trying to do your best to do right and it feels like you aren't on anybody's radar? Or maybe it's the other side of that coin. Maybe it's the opposite. You feel like the ship has already sailed. You feel like nobody's watching, and you've been left to your own devices to do whatever it is you feel like you want to. So whether you feel like nobody's watching, or you feel like you've had a lifetime of trying to do what's right, and it's gone unnoticed, I want to say this morning, you haven't been overlooked. You know, something I've noticed recently, I've noticed it on walks with my family in our neighborhood. I've noticed it at the YMCA, whether it's in the gym or on the treadmill. Everybody's using these. Everybody's got earbuds in. You probably have a pair. I've got a pair of earbuds. Mine are kind of open ear, so I don't get run over by a car when I'm running. These aren't mine. I borrowed these from somebody. I'm about to stick them in my ears, so they're about to be mad at me. But you do. You're in the gym, you're doing something, and you're talking to somebody who's right beside you, and you think you're having a great conversation, and you look over, and they're bumping their own music. And you're like, oh, I guess I'm by myself here. I guess even though we're really close, we're really just working out on our own. We're really just walking on our own. It's like we're in our own little bubble. We're all tuned into our own little worlds, listening to our own music, our own podcast. Or sometimes, if you're mischievous like me, sometimes I put the earbuds in and I don't listen to anything. I just go, I'm going to listen to you, and you're not going to know it. Here's the question. While we're focused more on whatever we want to be instead of those around us, what should the believer, what should the follower of Jesus be tuned into? Ears open, listening for God's guidance, for opportunities he's giving us. Soft hearts that will respond with humility and repentance when God makes his will and his way apparent to us. A strong drive not to listen to our desires but to his. That's not easy though. Most of us struggle to tune into what God wants us to hear, and instead, we tune into a different soundtrack. God wants us to listen to him. He wants to talk to us, to lead us. But you know what soundtrack it is that we're bumping? I want to talk about me, want to talk about I, want to talk about number one. Oh my, my, what I think, what I like. What I'm not a square dancer, so I probably shouldn't be dancing. I like talking about you guys remember this track? Toby Keith, I'm going to talk about me, right? That's the soundtrack that most of us spend all of our time listening to. You know, hey, I like listening to anybody else just as much as the next, but really the person I want to talk about is me. The person I want to make decisions based on is me. We're tuned into ourselves. What we need to pursue, though, the soundtrack that we need to tune into goes something more like this. That's a harder song not to listen to, but to mean, to feel, to get to the point where we're tuned into Jesus and we're saying, we're singing, we're meaning, we're tuned in to saying, your will, your way. So who are you listening to? Because if we're not careful, if we spend too much time listening to the wrong soundtracks, the wrong voices in our lives, we're going to become completely out of touch with reality. We will be surrounded by people, but we will be by ourselves. And do you know what that leads to? It leads to us forgetting what reality truly is. And that reality is that we're not the main character in God's story. This life, the lives we live, are not about us. But that doesn't mean that we don't matter. It doesn't mean that we've been forgotten by God either. If we begin to believe that life is about us, if we listen to that Toby Keith song, hey, let's talk about me, 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 we begin to think the world revolves around us and that self-centeredness is going to take root in our lives. And what grows out of that selfishness? It's sinful behavior. And we have to ask ourselves, have we become so tuned in to what we want that we've tuned out to what God has for us, that we don't even recognize that our behavior is missing the mark and becoming sinful? Here's the tension in this week's passage, the second part of Mark chapter 6 we're going to look at. We're going to spend most of our time today talking about two background characters in the Gospel of Mark, the life of Jesus. And both of these characters only briefly come to the front of the stage as Mark tells us a story of the life of Jesus. And we have to ask ourselves, who would we rather be? The one who's put in prison and beheaded, and the one who was king and had the other imprisoned? And you might hear those two options and go, hey, Matt, that's a no-brainer. I'd like to have a brain instead of have my brain removed from me. But the answer that leads you to an abundant, eternal life might surprise you. So if you've got your Bibles, go ahead and open with me. Mark chapter 6, if you've got them on your phones, if you're at home, you can pull it up or go grab your Bible if you're streaming online. We're going to start in verse 14. King Herod heard about this, for Jesus' name had become well known. So he's talking about what we just heard about, what we just learned about last week. And some were saying, John the Baptist has been raised from the dead, and that's why miraculous powers are at work in him. Others said, he is Elijah. And they're talking about Jesus right now. Still others claimed, he is a prophet like one of the prophets long ago. But when Herod heard this, he said, John, whom I beheaded, has been raised from the dead. So first off, word has reached Herod about Jesus and all the incredible things that Jesus is doing. Everybody's talking, and it's risen to the point that all the way in the bigger cities, here's Herod in his elite circles, in his royal circles, and he's hearing about Jesus. But whoa, time out, wait a second. We haven't heard from John the Baptist since week one of this series. And all of a sudden, we're reading in Mark chapter 6 that he's dead. What happened? I mean, just rewind for a second with me all the way back to February when we started this series. And I said, hey, the beginning of the greatest story ever told about the most important person of all human history actually starts about talking about somebody else. And that somebody else was John the Baptist. And we talked week one of this series about how John the Baptist's purpose was to announce to the world that Jesus had arrived. John had to tell the people to get ready because the Messiah was coming. So the guy who announced Jesus arriving on the scene pops back into the story in Mark 6. And it's just to tell us that he's been killed. There's a lot going on here. Before we begin to hear about how John the Baptist died, I think we need to press pause and talk about who in the world this King Herod guy is. So this King Herod guy, there's several Herods in the gospel stories. This King Herod is actually a pretend king. He gave himself that title. He made people call him king. He asked Emperor Augustus in Rome if he could be called king, and the emperor said no. He still, though, turned around to the Israelites that he was ruling a portion of and said, yeah, you still got to call me king. He was more like regional assistant to the current emperor and king. His actual title was Herod Antipas, and he was a tetrarch, which means he was one of four rulers. He ruled a portion of Israel. He had authority in part of the sandbox. He wanted to be called king so badly that it didn't just take being refused by Emperor Augustus. He ended up being so focused on being called king that it cost him his power. He ended up being removed later on and exiled by Rome. Okay, back to Mark chapter 6, where Mark is saying, by the way, side note, John the Baptist is dead. He's not making this some major plot point in the story. He's saying, hey, King Herod started to hear about Jesus, and King Herod thought it was John the Baptist. Oh, by the way, John the Baptist is dead. We learn about John's death as a flashback? I mean, I thought he was important. It's the same way in the other Gospels. In the Gospel of Matthew and the Gospel of Luke, it tells us that Jesus went to Galilee, which was in northern Israel, while John the Baptist was in prison in southern Israel. And so John sends his disciples to Jesus because he thinks Jesus has forgotten about him. He thinks Jesus doesn't realize he's in prison. He goes, hey man, are you the one? And he's really asking in a polite way, like, you gonna come get me? You gonna bail me out? Like, hey, we've seen the miracles. Come on, man. We're supposed to bring about the kingdom of God. And surprisingly, Jesus doesn't rush to his rescue. The Gospel of John, written by one of Jesus' disciples, John, not John the Baptist, he mentions John the Baptist's imprisonment as well. He writes about it in John chapter 3. In John chapter 3, John's disciples, John the Baptist's disciples, ask John, they say, hey, are you upset that Jesus is getting to be more popular than you? And man, John says something incredibly deep, especially in the context of the story we're going through today. John 3:30, he says, I must decrease, he must increase. John knew he wasn't the main character of the story. He wasn't even the main character of his life. And it wasn't always easy for him to tune into God's story, God's plan, but it was what he had built his life around, tuning in to what God wanted. Picking up in verse 17, for Herod himself had given orders to have John arrested, and he had him bound and put in prison. Why did he have him bound and put in prison? He did this because of Herodias, his brother Philip's wife, whom he had married. That's not a typo. You read that correctly. His brother Philip's wife, whom he had married. For John had been saying to Herod, it's not lawful for you to have your brother's wife. So Herodias nursed a grudge against John and wanted to kill him, but she was not able to, because Herod feared John and protected him, knowing him to be a righteous and holy man. When Herod heard John, he was greatly puzzled. Yet he liked to listen to him. So circle back to verse 18. What got John in trouble? Did he break the law? Was he caught red-handed? No. But did he do something dangerous? Yeah. He called out sinful behavior. Herod might have been an imposter king, a make-believe king, but he still had real authority given to him by the Roman Empire. And John exhibited tremendous courage by rebuking Herod publicly. He was a powerful Roman ruler who could have executed John whenever he pleased. But John still decided to call out sin. Let's talk about that uncomfortable word for just a second. Let's talk about sin. It's a word that means missing the mark. It's when instead of going along the road that God has for us, we begin to drift left of center, go across the double yellow lines, and start driving into oncoming traffic. Man, sin, it's a word we don't like because it's a behavior that all of us struggle with avoiding. We know it's dangerous, but all of us, to some level, feel like we're capable of weaving in and out of traffic head on and getting back in the right lane at the right time. Listen to how the Apostle Paul talks about this drift from God's plan in the book of Romans. He calls us to get back on track. Therefore, don't let sin reign in your mortal body so that you obey its evil desires. Don't get off track. Don't offer any part of your body to sin as an instrument of wickedness, but rather offer yourselves to God. Stay the course as those who have been brought from death to life, and offer every part of yourself to him as an instrument for righteousness. For sin shall no longer be your master, because you're not under law, but you're under grace. Paul says, hey, don't try and dodge the vehicles. Don't head off of course, but let grace be your guide. Jesus talks about sin and how destructive it is in the next chapter of Mark. Mark chapter 7, verses 20 through 23. He went on, what comes out of a person is what defiles them, for it is from within, out of a person's heart, that evil thoughts come. Sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, lewdness, envy, slander, arrogance, and folly. All these evils come from inside and defile a person. All of us, somewhere in that list. And we go, yeah, okay, yep. Yeah, I don't like it, but I know it's true. I know that's the thing that I just drift off course for. Are we willing to call sin, sin? Are we willing to acknowledge when we're in the wrong lane, when we're at risk, when we're putting ourselves and others at risk? I want to offer a caution to each of us here as we're talking about sin. I'm not talking about calling out sin by lobbing a self-righteous hand grenade from a safe distance. I'm not talking about dunking on somebody on social media and calling out something that you just think needs to be called out as sin while you go off, turn your device off, and enjoy how self-righteous you feel. I'm talking about, are we willing to acknowledge the areas that we miss the mark? And with discernment and with care and with love, are we willing to speak hard words to the people around us that care about us, that we care about, and say, hey, be careful, because you're driving off course and it's going to end up hurting somebody. It all comes back. It all comes back to what we choose to listen to. What are we going to do? Are we going to believe the lie that life is about us? Are we going to try and tune into the real author of life, the real giver of hope? Or are we going to start bumping that Toby Keith song again?
I want to talk about me, want to talk about I, want to talk about number one, oh my, me, my, what I think, what
this,
I like, what
this
I know,
song
what
hits a little bit different after the conversation we just had, doesn't it?
But occasionally,
we hear that, and man, in our gut, you know, the first time you go, okay, that was a little funny. I want to talk about me, want to talk about me. You know, me, 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 me. And man, now that we've got the struggles we have with staying on track in our mind, you go, I don't feel as good about that anymore. Do we want to listen to that song? Is that the soundtrack that we are listening to? Or are we striving to say, your will, your way? You hear that, and you go, man, that's a hard song to sing. But when we think about staying on the right side of those double yellow lines, man, we know that's not me, 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 me. We know we need to follow somebody else. We know that we need to tune in. One leads us to drifting further and further from the life God has for us. But saying your will, your way, it is not easy at all. I mean, John the Baptist was not a self-centered guy. John the Baptist lived an incredibly difficult life. I mean, he chose a lot of hardships because of the mission that he felt like he was called to. He was an incredibly spiritual person who desired to follow after God. But here he is in a prison cell, and he's going, hey, God, have you forgotten me? He's having this moment where he's picking up the earbuds and he's going, can we just talk about me for a second? He struggled with the reality that Jesus wasn't rescuing him. Christ-like people, people that want to be like Jesus, can still really struggle with not making life about them. Both these guys were tempted by sin. Both these guys were tempted to listen to the me, 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 me. Both of them responded differently. Let's see how this story plays out. Verse 21. Finally, the opportune time came. On his birthday, Herod gave a banquet for his high officials, military commanders, and the leading men of Galilee. When the daughter of Herodias came in and danced, she pleased Herod and his dinner guests. The king said to the girl, ask me anything you want and I'll give it to you. And he promised her with an oath, whatever you ask, I will give you up to half my kingdom. I've just got to note a couple things in this section. First thing, Herod threw a birthday party for himself. We hear that and we go, perfectly normal. We do it every year, right? In the ancient world, first century, Jewish people believed that birthdays were pagan. My wife's birthday is next week. I'm just telling you, hon, it's sinful for us to have a birthday party for you. So just trying to be spiritual. Yeah, your will, your way. But for Mark, we hear it and we read right past it. But first century listeners would have heard Herod throwing a birthday party for himself, and they would have said, man, what soundtrack is he listening to? And then the other thing is that Herodias' daughter's dance, Herod's stepdaughter and niece, it was not a ballet recital. It was not, hey, check out this new dance I've learned. It was something much more of the R-rated variety. Herod's birthday party is filled with layer upon layer of sinful behavior. He's listened to this self-centered soundtrack for so long and surrounded himself with so many people singing that same "Wanna Talk About Me" soundtrack that everybody at this party is lost in this self-destructive behavior. And so Herodias' daughter, she goes out and said to her mother, "What shall I ask for?" "The head of John the Baptist," she answered. At once the girl hurried into the king with the request, "I want you to give me right now the head of John the Baptist on a platter. The king was greatly distressed because of his oaths and his dinner guests. He didn't want to refuse her. So he sent immediately an executioner with orders to bring John's head. The man went, beheaded John in the prison, and brought back his head on a platter. He presented it to the girl, and she gave it to her mother. On hearing this, John's disciples came and took his body and laid him in a tomb. Herod is put into a place where he's got to make a decision. Does he want the party to stop? Does he want to do what's right? Or does he want to stay in his pretend little kingdom? Does he want to listen to his delusional little soundtrack? Does he change the music? Does he pull out the earbuds? No. He chooses sin. And in this situation, Herod stands in pathetic contrast to Jesus. Jesus never played to the crowds. Herod, however, could not deny this girl's request because of the crowd. I love how one commentary puts it. He could have said to Herodias' daughter, he could have said, "I promised you a gift, not a crime." But that's not what he did. He just kept trying to dodge the oncoming traffic. And he added sin upon sin and tried to pretend he was still king. And so here you are. At some point this morning, you're going to have this moment of realization. So Matt, you're telling me I should desire to be like the guy who lost his head? That because Jesus is the true king and Herod is the pretender with a party, that I should feel okay being overlooked, doing the right thing, and getting punished? I mean, imagine that Monday morning conversation with your coworkers. "Hey, man, how was church this week?" "It was great. Pastor Matt told us that we should be like this guy who had his head cut off and put on a silver platter. You want to come to church with me next week?" No. It's not a feel-good story. This story doesn't end the way we want it to. It doesn't end the way John the Baptist or his followers want it to either. They put him in a tomb and the story moves on. Mark's little aside into telling us what happened to John the Baptist with Herod is over, and once again he goes back to the main story of Jesus. That's a tough pill to swallow. This past weekend, my family had a chance to go on Saturday to the Ohio State spring game. It's like a practice that 75,000 people go to. It's crazy. And then on Sunday, as a family, we ran in this Ohio State 4-mile race that finishes on the 50-yard line of Ohio Stadium. You get to run through the end zone, and they've got players that are current players and former players lined up on both sides of the finish line, and you've got a bib on that has your name on it. And so my kids are running across the finish line, and the players they normally cheer for are cheering for them. "Go Zeke, go Malachi, come on, you can do this." How cool. And all weekend long, I thought, man, I need to text my friend. I need to tell my friend how cool this is. I think 4 or 5 times I thought, I need to text my friend. But I couldn't text him because my friend fought cancer and he beat it only to get COVID. And he didn't have the immune system to fight it off. And so all weekend I'm going, man, my buddy would love this. Man, I miss my buddy. Such an incredible guy who loved Jesus. And it didn't seem right, and it doesn't seem right now. So many people are listening to their own soundtrack, doing whatever they want, and it feels like that nothing ever happens to them. But this great guy had to die on his own in a hospital bed. How can we be okay with that? And it's not just my story. You've got names that are attached to those stories too. You've got people that you're going, "God, what about this? Why didn't you rescue this person? Why didn't you answer this prayer? Why didn't you solve this?" Let's rewind one more time to the very beginning of Mark. Mark 1, verse 1. The beginning of the good news about Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of God. Verses 2 and 3 up on the screen, they're a prophecy about John the Baptist preparing the way, tuning people into God. But John isn't the main character in this story. Herod's not the main character in this story. Verse 1 says, hey, this is about Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of God. We aren't the main characters in this story. Herod and his family completely missed Jesus while they were playing king and queen of their sinful kingdom. John had to come to grips with it, that the kingdom of God wasn't going to be inaugurated like he thought. He had to be okay with his earthly story ending with him in a prison cell and his disciples putting him in a tomb. We have to face the music that our lives are not going to play out according to whatever script that we have with them. That it will seem like injustice is everywhere around us and doing the right thing isn't paying off, but it doesn't mean that we've been forgotten by God. John is the forerunner of Jesus' message in ministry. He says, hey, Jesus is coming. And in this week's reading, we see that John is also telling us that Jesus' death is coming. Jesus has just warned the 12 disciples that preaching their word, the word of God, will not always be welcomed. But as a theologian once said, one's tombstone may serve as a trumpet, one's grave a megaphone of a life well lived for the glory of a great king whose name is Jesus. What will our lives say? Will they just be a whole lot of me, 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 me? Or will we choose to say, your will, your way? You know what? Today, no one names their kid Herod. There's millions, on the other hand, that bear the name John. It's not easy, but we need to tune into Jesus. Even when he says in Mark 8:34, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. I'm supposed to take up a cross and follow Jesus? If Jesus loved us enough to die for us on a cross too, and if we're going to make Jesus our king, we're going to have to trust that he knows best, even if we have crosses to bear. Are we willing to change our tune, to stop singing the me, me, me's, the want to talk about me, and start singing your will, your way? When it comes to sin in our lives, when it comes to the direction or circumstances in our lives, who are we listening to? I want to talk about me or your will, your way. The way we respond isn't going to fix all our problems. Jesus never promised that it would. We're not going to be liked by everybody, but one decision leads us to oncoming traffic and the other leads us to real and abundant life with Jesus, even if it doesn't happen exactly like we would like it to. So what should the believer be tuned into? What should be the soundtrack that we have in our ears? Your will, your way, in the needs of the world around us. Your will, your way, wherever you want to lead me. Your will, your way, so I don't allow sin to control and wreck my life. Your will, your way, not my desires but yours. Not my will, but yours be done. We're going to enter into a time of communion now. And if it's your first time or you're watching online and you need to get communion from one of the bags around the room, or maybe you need to press pause and get up and get something for communion, that's fine. But that last line, not my will, but yours be done, it definitely wasn't King Herod that said that. And John the Baptist said something similar in John 3:30 when he said, I must decrease and he must increase. But those words, as we get ready to have communion, those are the words of Jesus. Those are the words of Jesus before he embraced his cross, the cross that he embraced to save us. The reason that we're having communion, to recognize that Jesus' blood shed, his body broken, were for us, so that we could have hope, not just for this temporary life, but for eternal life. Jesus was looking at the cross set before him, and he said to his heavenly Father, is there any other way? And then he said, okay, not my will, but yours be done. Jesus isn't asking us to listen to a soundtrack that he isn't listening to himself. So as we have communion now, as I pray for us, tune into Jesus. And let's echo that prayer, not my will, but yours be done. Let's pray. God, we thank you so much that you do love us. And God, I'll admit, I feel like John the Baptist sometimes. I feel like I'm in a prison cell going, hey, Jesus, you do know where I am, right? While it feels like evil people succeed all around me. This morning, God, just help me to see that you embraced a cross so that you could rescue me not from my temporary problems, but from the biggest mess I've made in my whole life. The moments where I've gone off center, my own sin. As we have communion now, Lord, help us to tune into you and not make it about us, but say your will, your way. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's have communion now.
Now found every blessing to my heart to sing thy praise. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the upon it, mount of thy redeeming name. Here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by thy help I'm come, and I hold by thy good safely to arrive at home. Jesus saw me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue
door to grace, how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy grace, Lord, like a fetter, binds my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. He's my heart. Take his seal, seal it for thy courts above. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. He's my heart. For thy courts above. He's my heart, Lord. Take his seal and seal it for thy courts above.
God, we just come to you right now, and as we are hearing the words, just take up our own cross to deny ourselves, to make you the true king in our lives. God, I pray this week that we're able to seek you and grow with you and just focus on you in these moments where we need to be putting you first. God, when that happens, we know you're going to move. So God, I just pray that we're trusting in you, we're obedient to you and all the things. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. Amen. You guys have a great week.